has been hit by a disaster, and I've been personally affected when the hurricanes happened. The island where I grew up was basically obliterated, you know, South Caicos. And in the midst of that, my favorite aunt also died. So here I am 2 years later, Haiti gets hit by an earthquake, and I come out of it and I lost some really good friends and really good sources, and it was very difficult for me to wrap my mind around that. But then, you know, a couple of weeks later, I'm standing there with my family, burying a family member who, you know, suffered from a heart condition for years, but right after another aftershock, he died. So for those of us who were in that sort of very different class of people who didn't lose a family member on January 12th, you know, you had this bit of a sense of guilt, you know, but also a sense of relief. But then you go post January 12th, and now you have somebody that's died. And whether you prove it or not, it's related to the quake, it forever becomes this marker in your mind. You know, it's like 50 years from now, you know, where were you on January 12th, or what happened to you as a result of January 12th? Oh yeah, I lost someone. My cousin knew he was gonna die. I mean, I sit and I talk to family members and my mother. My mother says that he called her. The last words that he said to my mother was that, "I'm gonna die and I'm not even gonna see you." And that week he called people all over. I mean, you know, people who he hadn't talked to in ages. You know, and I think that he just knew. And even though, you know, his house did not collapse, he did not lose any of his children. But seeing this and seeing what happened in this place, I just think that he just got to a point where he just says, I just can't anymore. I don't think that I'm going to live long enough to see it change. That every time you think that it's going to change, something just so incredible that you just did not imagine could happen, and that's what it is. So I think that that's what it is. That, you know, how is it that people can hang on and hold on for so long? Because it's hope. And it's this idea of hoping and believing, because that's all they have. And when the Haitians no longer have hope, they die. I have yet to meet someone who's Haitian who lives here and who has not said to me that I know several people who have died since January 12th. And while we can say that this is a country where, because of the population, because of the way in which people live, that, you know, death is a part of life. I mean, this is a country that's prone to disasters, but it's a different kind of death that's happening today. It's stories about people dying because of heart attacks. It's stories because of anxiety. It's happening right after another aftershock. And so here we are today. It's not about kids dying of malnutrition. We know that's gonna happen. It's not about the diarrhea because of the water that people are drinking or the conditions that are in the camp. It's about, you know, an old woman who's lived 80 some years and it's basically saying, I just can't anymore. It's about going to sleep every night with this anxiety of having another aftershock and just saying, whatever. before I came on this trip, I went to the produce section in Alapata, and I bought 5 bags of 110 kilos of rice and 2 cases of cooking oil and, you know, and beans, and because I don't want to be, and my mother doesn't want to be, the person that at that funeral the priest talks about how you never sent anything, you never fed your family, and now they've died and you've come and you've put on this elaborate funeral. You know, so when you are out of here, you were reminded of that. I come to Haiti, I come on vacation, and I stay with my family members, and I stay without electricity, and I, you know, I'm on the public transportation, I'm on to remind me, you know, of what it is and who I'm writing about. And that's me. I mean, you know, this is my story.